Okay, so recording. So hello, and thank you for joining us, Venerable Yönten. This is just to allow our community to get to know you a little bit better and to know the topic a little bit better. So I'd like to ask you a few questions. Is that all right? Yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Of course.
So can you tell us where you're from and how you became a Buddhist?
I'm from Montana, and I think I just always looked up to His Holiness whenever his name came across the news, even when I was a kid. He was kind of a superhero to me when I was a kid. And fortunately, even though I'm from a relatively small town, it's the capital, and there were a few little Buddhist groups, so that when I was a teenager, I could go sit with some groups on the weekends and sometimes go to little short retreats, and just kind of built organically from there.
Mm. And what is it like? So you're ordained, you're a nun. What led you to do that? And what's it like being a Western ordained person?
Well, I don't know. I can only speak from my own experience. But for me, being a regular Buddhist, a lay Buddhist, was very nourishing. It was something that gave me a lot of joy. But because of, you know, the nature of a layperson's life, there were a lot of distractions that I felt like theoretically could become a part of my path, ideally could become a part of my path. But for me and my personality and my learning style, it seemed a more efficient way to become ordained. So not having family life and not having children and not having those kind of obligations, on one sense, is a sacrifice that I make for sentient beings. And on another hand, is a freedom in order to pursue things that I want to go into more deeply. So I see it as kind of like a lifestyle choice, as opposed to something better or worse than anything else. It's just a lifestyle that suits me. Having lots of vows gives me a lot of structure, which helps me be more efficient with my practice and waste less time.
Yeah,
but of course, it is a strange thing in the West. It's not a common thing. So there's some hardship related to that. But
yeah, culturally and yeah. I can understand the efficiency. Sometimes I dream about that.
and sometimes the efficiency is theoretical. You know, the mind will find ways to make itself busy with unnecessary things in any life. So, yeah. But I moved to Chenrezig Institute when I was 19 in Australia, and
right.
That's where I really was able to focus in and do my study live in community. So,
Yeah. The idea of living in a community of like-minded people can be very appealing.
It helps.
It doesn't always work that way, but
yeah, it helps.
And the last question, just for this brief interview, was on the topic of karma and reality. Can you give some examples of how this topic has helped you personally, and maybe some people that you teach or that you're friends with, and some examples of how this has really made life easier, better?
It's two really major philosophical components of Buddhism. Talking about karma, you know, you're looking at cause and effect, and you're looking at how to live a more ethical life, a life without harmfulness, developing really deep roots to support your compassion and your loving kindness, which is all very accessible and makes a lot of sense logically and experientially. But then you look at the teachings on reality and the fact that all of those ethics and all of that good and bad only exists within a context. You know, that nothing is kind of a self-existent good or a self-existent bad, and how to hold that truth without going into some sort of weird view of hedonism or despair or apathy. You know, how do you stay on that razor's edge that acknowledges that there is positive and negative, while at the same time acknowledging that only exists within a certain framework and context? And so this teaching, I think, can really help you be liberated from the paralysis that can come from going too much one side or the other. You know, if you're really remembering the way reality is, then it stops you becoming a fundamentalist about your ethics and about your worldview. And if you're having a really enriched connection with your ethics and your worldview and wanting to be of benefit to others, and you're remembering reality, then it can kind of free up the present moment where you know, okay, generally speaking, this, this, and this is good, but right here, does that make sense? So it keeps you from, I guess, falling into trap habit and losing the creativity and spontaneity of the moment, which asks, what does bodhicitta look like in this moment, as opposed to all the moments before?
Right.
So they're mutually reinforcing, and they sound contradictory, and they're not.
You know, thank you so much. I'm so glad we have you teaching. I'm really looking forward to this. I'm quite happy to have you teaching on this topic. And the way you're presenting it is really very fresh. And so, this is going to be a great weekend. Thanks for helping us get to know you a little bit and this topic.
Thanks so much.
Look forward to seeing you. It's next weekend, isn't it? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Take care.
Yeah. See you soon.
See you again soon. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye.